Hi, my name is Iray. I'm a program manager working on Microsoft Planner. I'm excited to tell you all about the Planner APIs that we've exposed on the Microsoft Graph. Today, we're going to go and do a little bit of an overview on Planner and then talk about the APIs. I'm also going to cover some of the recent API updates we've made in the past couple of months. And then from there, I'll spend a bunch of time demoing just to give you a sense of how the API works and walk through some simple examples. For those of you who are not that familiar with Planner, Planner is a collaborative task management tool that's included as part of Office 365. Anytime that you're working with a team of people and want to go and track work, know who's doing what, you know, what needs to get done, and are we on track, Planner is a great tool for you to go and use. Whenever you use Planner, you create a plan, and within that plan, you have a collection of tasks. We provide a couple of different visualizations for each of these tasks. We have a task board where you can see all of the tasks organized by buckets. We also provide some out-of-the-box charts, as well as a schedule view. One of the recent changes that we've made with Planner during the past year is doing deeper integration across Office 365. And so anytime that you're thinking about a collaboration experience, Planner should be there for you. So in addition to the Planner clients, we've now integrated Planner into Microsoft Teams, as well as to SharePoint. Now let's go and step into some of the core concepts of Planner. So as I noted in the previous slide, Planner is built off of the group service in Office 365. What groups are is that groups go and define a named collection of members. Each group owns a collection of plans. And then within the plans themselves, you also have buckets, as well as the tasks. I'll go and walk through all of these during the API later, but that's kind of the basic concepts of all Planner is. When you go and drill into any of the tasks, you also have the notion of task details. This is where we store additional metadata about the task. So you can have things like a description as well as checklists. Next is that you also have the ability to attach files and attach links to a task. This is also associated on task details. And then finally, having comments and conversations on a task. And these are all powered by Outlook group conversations. The cool thing about all of these things is that Planner itself is also built using the Microsoft Graph. And we go and call the very same APIs that you call to go and power these experiences. And if you're not that familiar with the Microsoft Graph, I'm glad that you're here watching this video. So the Microsoft Graph is the unified REST API that we use to access all of the data that's stored within Office 365, as well as other services. As I noted, Planner itself uses a lot of the Graph APIs to build its experiences. You can see on this slide that any of the items that are highlighted green are actual APIs that Planner uses. In addition to the other services we integrate with, we also expose all of the Planner data via the Graph itself. And so you could actually go and build an app as rich as Planner using just the Graph APIs too. Some of the key APIs that we've exposed related to Planner are around the tasks and plans that Planner stores in its service. Some of the key things are just getting all of the tasks that you know are belong to me as a user, getting all the tasks in a particular plan, and then of course seeing all the plans that are associated with a particular group. A couple of the main API updates that we've made is since exposing plans across a lot of these different contexts and these different collaboration experiences, wanted to provide additional capabilities to help make it easier for you and users to manage the plans. Some of the new APIs that we've recently released onto the beta endpoint for Microsoft Graph include favorite plans and recent plans. So now you have the ability to specify specific plans that you want to favorite and see that in your UI. This is a slight change from the past where we were leveraging favorite groups as that proxy. In addition to favorite plans, now that with the plans show up in different spots, we also expose the notion of a plan context on plan details. And this gives you a little bit of additional information of where that plan is being used or where that plan is being created. And with that, let me go and show you on a demo. We'll start the demo from the Planner web browser experience. So what you're seeing here is the Planner hub. And you can see all of the favorite plans that I have, as well as my recent plans and a list of all the plans. Whenever I click into any of these plans, you can go and see that I have my different buckets like engineering, manufacturing, and so on, as well as each of the task cards themselves. And then as before, when I click through, I can go and see all the metadata associated with that given task. In addition to these board charts and schedules that I mentioned, we also have another view called My Tasks. My Tasks shows you all of the tasks that are assigned to you across all of your different plans. Let me show you what that looks like within the Graph API. So I'm going to hop over to the Graph Explorer here. And then the whole structure for Planner is pretty straightforward. In order to go and see any of the tasks that are assigned to me, I can just go and say me/planner/tasks and hit run, and that shows me all of the same tasks that are currently assigned to me below. If I want to see the tasks that belong to a specific plan, I can do that pretty easily as well. Just from Planner, I'll go and grab the plan ID, and then if I go back over here, I can go and see all of the tasks for that particular plan. And I can also do things like see all of the buckets. And then as I noted before, one of the newer features that we have is adding more details and context to each of the plans. And so this particular plan is actually also used within the context of SharePoint as well as in Teams. And so when I go and look at the details of it off of the beta endpoint, you'll see some of the additional information associated there. And so if you look down here, you can actually see that it has the notion of context details. And so it can say that here, this is one that we created from the from the Teams context. And then here's another one that we created from the SharePoint context. And in each of these cases, we also store a URL that gives you access to that particular plan within that context. And so, for example, if I wanted to open this in Teams, you can just go and access that URL, and the same with the URL that you have for SharePoint. Next, I'm going to go and show you actually going and creating a plan from scratch. There's a couple of steps involved in doing this, and so let me go and walk through each of these. As I noted in the presentation before, every plan today is owned by a group. And so the first step that you need to do is to actually go and create that group. In order to create a group, all you have to do is post to the group's endpoint. There's some basic metadata that you need to fill out about a group, and I've kind of copied over some of it here already. You can see that you can name the group whatever you want, so I'll just name it API group. And then you can specify a couple other things like the mail nickname and so on. When I go and run this query, that'll go and create the group. So let me do that. Okay, great. And so now that I have my group below, I'm going to grab the ID for that group because I'm going to use it for a couple of the remaining steps. After I've created the group, it's important to go and add the current user to be a member of that group as well. So by default, whenever you create a group, the person who created it is added as an owner of that group, but we also want to make sure that they're a member so they can participate in the actual collaboration there. In order to add a member to a group, you post to that navigation. And then in this case, I'm going to add the current user. And so I happened to copy over the current user's ID previously, but you could always use the samples here, just get that user's ID and add that in. So when I go and run that query, I've seen that now I've succeeded and I've added that user to the group. To check that everything worked out correctly, you can always go and do a quick read on that same group and look at the members list. And if it all went well, I should see myself in that list. And so correct, I see Alex Wilbur is now a member of that same group. Next, I'm going to go and show creating a plan for that given group. In order to create a plan, you need to just specify a title and then the group that it's owned by. This is a common question that people have, is that when they see the owner field, they think that, oh, this should be the owner, like a user for it. But in this particular case, because we're talking at the API level, this is the owner from a group perspective. And so it's the group that's containing that plan. And so what I'm going to do here is copy over the ID I specified before, and then I'm going to have a plan called API demo plan. And then I'm going to make sure this is a post. And I'm going to go and create that now as well. OK, and now that I've completed that, you can see that it does say success, and I have a plan ID that I can use. The next thing I'm going to show is actually adding that plan to my favorites collection for easier access going forward. So let me go and copy that over. So the first thing I want to do is actually look at all of the favorites that I have so far. And so if you go to beta.me/planner/favorite plans, you could see all of the favorites that I currently have for this user. This basically maps to that same call that you saw on the hub previously. Okay. You can also look at all of these, both the favorites and recent, in one call by just removing that last segment. So if I go like this, you could see kind of an abbreviated version of my favorites, as well as my recent plans. This is actually useful if you want to go and render just the list of plans in one quick call without a lot of the extra metadata. Okay. So in order to go and add something to this, what I'm going to do is do a patch. And let me grab the stuff I want to patch here. And then I'm also going to add the request header for. So I need to grab the etag. Oops. And then I'll grab the etag just to make sure I have the most recent. Okay, then going back to the request, I need to go and actually take the plan ID and add that to my favorite. So this is the plan ID from the plan I had in the previous step. And then I'm going to have an order hint. This is specifying that it should be the last one there. And then finally, I'm going to have the plan title here. And so one thing that you'll notice is that while you specify a plan title when you go and set the favorites, the planner clients will always go and fix this up whenever you navigate to those plans to make sure that the plan titles are up to date. And so in this case, I do have the API demo plan. And let me just go and run that. OK, and so that succeeded. So now when I go back to the planner side of things, and I'll do a quick refresh because it might take a second, I can see that that new API demo plan that I created is now included in my favorites as well. Next, I can show a little bit of how to go and add buckets and tasks to that same plan. So I start back over here. I'm going to grab the plan ID again. And then I'm going to now start posting to create the buckets. So creating buckets is pretty straightforward as well. Let me switch back to V1. Oops, sorry. OK, so if I want to go and create buckets now, all I have to do is specify for each bucket what the order is, and then the plan it belongs to, as well as the name of the bucket itself. And so I'm going to do that a couple times. So grabbing that plan ID again, click over here. So that's bucket one. Let me run this. I'm going to do this two more times, bucket two. And then bucket three. Okay, and I'm going to now grab the bucket ID for that last bucket, and we can put a couple of tasks into it too. Okay, so if I click over here, I should see I have my three buckets. Great, and so now I'm going to go and add some tasks to that last bucket. So to add tasks, you just post to planner/tasks. And then in this case, you have to specify the title, the plan, the bucket of that task. And you can also assign it to people if you want to as well. And so for example, if I wanted to assign it to the user early on, you can go and do that too. I'm going to actually just remove that for now. and then go and update all of these to the right info. So I grab my plan ID from earlier. Now I'm going to grab my bucket ID. And then task from API 1, run the query. Do that one or two more times, two. And then three. Okay, and so now if I hop back to Planner, it might take a second, but you should be able to see that I now have three tasks popping in. Let me refresh. And I have my three tasks from the API there as well. And now you can go and start planning as you see fit. Okay, that was just a really quick overview of what you can do with the API. You know, one of the common things that we see a lot is that if you want to go and set up a plan to match your structure, a lot of folks have been using the API to go and specify a set of tasks and a set of buckets to use to go and create new plans with. Other common scenarios people also use is to try to go and create tasks from other systems within Planner, and then you can easily go and collaborate them within the Planner experiences as well as our experiences within Teams and SharePoint. Well, thanks for taking the time to hear a little bit about Planner APIs today. I hope you liked what you saw and want to go and start trying out the API. Happy planning.